ladies, they will be happy to accommodate. Thank you very much and good luck. Thank you.
Thank you.
Drive safe.
Drive safe. Lori, before you go, I want to be able to say thank you to you for inviting me and for hosting me, and I want to also thank Raya and Laura for all your help. Now you can go, Lori. Thank you very much. In fact, I want to thank all of you, and because I said to Miriam the other day, you know, it may be a nice intimate group of just the four of us, your two children, and that would have been fine too, because it's hard to tell, I think, whether it's other events that are taking place this evening. There's an event in Beit Shemesh focused on halachic Jewish law prenuptial agreement, which I would be at if I wasn't here. I'm very committed to that particular social, religious, and cultural issue. And I just appreciate all of your taking the time to come. Some of you I know, some of you I know well, some of you I've stayed with your community, and some of you I've worked with for years, and some of you I don't know at all. And I very much appreciate your all coming. And the truth is, although I have kind of some prepared remarks to share with you, because we're a small group, and this is an intimate setting, we had to choose, Ora and Raya and Marie and I, whether to hold it on the balcony with the beautiful view of the old city behind us, or whether to hold it inside here. And the idea of welcome, there's a seat there and here, I'm sorry, and then there's one here. And the idea of holding it in here included the fact that we could have some photos, but also it was going to be a small and intimate group. And it's not there. So I want to share some ideas with you. No, we come sit. There's a seat here and here too. And also here, but then. I think rather than my giving a 40-minute lecture of what it was like to hike the trail and what I learned, I want to start rather unusually. Continuing this theme of gratitude, I express my thanks to Uri and his team here and to all of you for coming. But it's kind of an irony that among the things that I learned while hiking the trail, which I'll talk about shortly, one of them, which I talk about in the book, is appreciation for all of the blessings that we have in our life. And my thanking you for taking time out of your evening or your busy schedule and coming from far or near to come and talk about this and hear about it, it kind of runs into the same theme. I'm not embarrassed to share with you that there's a picture here that will come up again and I'll point out to it, but this is, I just like having this running in the background to give a feel for some of the vistas, but I'm not going in a particular order according to the photos. There's a picture here of a particular wildflower, which after about 10 days of hiking in the desert sees nothing but dirt and rocks and ants and beetles. I came across this first spring blossom at the end of February in the midst of the desert, and I'm not ashamed to share with you that I cried. I cried out of sheer joy of appreciating this first color after weeks of nothing but dull browns and grays and blacks and rocks and what have you like this. That was the first day sitting up for Mila. And that was for me, and it's a great example to start a short explanation of what I've written a book about. It's a good example of how something that I discovered, as it were, on the trail was completely, almost immediately applicable to my trying to face the challenge, the personal challenge that I was facing at the time that I hiked the trail. Because the gratitude that I had for that one little flower made me, or helped me remind me of the appreciation that I have and that I want to have. You're right, that's it. That's exactly it.
Sorry.
That's it. And seeing that, and the tears of gratitude that I had at the time reminded me of how much I appreciate of all of the wonderful things I have in my life. We kind of get a little bit ahead of ourselves. That was just one example that I wanted to share with you within the context of the things that I was grateful for taking this hike. I hiked the Israel National Trail, as you saw in the invitation to this event, 600 miles or 1,000 kilometers over the course of 8 weeks with a 50-pound pack on my back, all alone. And it was a transformative experience. And it was transformative not only because of the beauty and because because of the challenge and because of my connection to our history and our people and our land and the diverse people that I met along the way, Jews and Druze and Bedouin and Christian Arabs and Muslim Arabs and the African Hebrew Israelites in Jerusalem and others, which were part of my journey here in Israel. But it was transformative in another way too, because I hiked the trail very soon after my divorce was finalized. And this was a divorce that I hadn't looked for. It was not my choice. It basically turned my life completely upside down. And any of you who have gone through, and most of you have, because most of us here are older than about 8 and a half, and therefore have had a life experience, anybody who's gone through a kind of personal trauma of either losing a loved one, obviously, or losing a job, or other challenges that we face, and certainly those of us who've gone through a divorce, can understand how devastating that can be. And just a few weeks after we finalized our divorce, I was out hiking the trail. And what for me was an exercise in, as one person said who I met on the trail weeks into it, Nikui Rosh, he said in Hebrew, you're clearing your head. I thought, great, you just summed up in two words what I've spent weeks trudging 12 hours a day, 20 or 30 kilometers a day discovering, that I was there to clear my head, to take a break, to reevaluate. And to a certain extent, what I learned on the trail, what I'm happy to share with you briefly, and then I will do it briefly, and then I'll be happy to go into any particular areas that you're more interested in and let you ask questions and direct me in certain directions. But what I learned on the trail weren't necessarily new ideas or revelations. The Ramchal says in Misilat Yesharim, that in his introduction, that he is not bringing anything new to bear on the issues that he's relating, which probably isn't true from an objective perspective, but what he says is it's worth repeating things that we know because it's important to reinforce the truths that we're already familiar with. And for me, the things that I learned on the trail that I want to share with you that then were applicable to me in my life and literally moving ahead with my life on the trail and moving on with my life after the divorce were things which I would say I rediscovered, which were reinforced in me. And what were those things? There were five lessons I learned on the trail. And I want to illustrate at least four of them with an anecdote from the trail, and then I'll close with kind of a final comment, and then I'll open to discussion or questions. The first thing I learned on the trail, which I learned in those weeks in the desert, surrounded by nothing, was an incredible sense of the infinite nature of the universe and the infinitesimally small place that I have in it. And that humility, that modesty, for me was a little bit frightening, a little bit awe-inspiring. I don't want to get into too much hyperbole in terms of feeling at one with the universe and having my own kind of revelatory experience like the Jews had at Mount Sinai. But there was a little bit of that, especially one day in the desert when I walked for 8 hours without seeing anything. And I want you to understand, even the pictures you see here in the desert, there are shrubs, there are beetles, there are birds overhead. There's some sound around you. Who knows what the largest national reserve in Israel is? Anybody? Take a guess. So I guarantee you won't get it unless you happen to live perhaps near it, like in Dimona. Anybody?
Fish. Fish
Gadol. Most people say Matesh, people say En Gedi, people say forests in the north. No, the largest in terms of square kilometers, the largest natural reserve, nature reserve in Israel is the Judean Desert Nature Reserve. And there's a reason that none of you have ever heard of it, because there's nothing there. When I say nothing, I mean not like some of these desert scenes where you see shrubs and plants and there's birds and there's sounds. I mean nothing. I walked for 8 hours in complete silence. I gave a talk on Parshat Bamidbar in the desert, as it were, the day before Shavuot, the day before we commemorate the giving of the Torah, and I related the issue that the Torah was given on Mount Sinai in a desert. That many of our prophets had their experiences in the desert. King David ran to and escaped from King Saul into the desert. We have a very interesting relationship with the silence of the desert and that still small voice that Eliyahu heard on Har Carmel. I had something like that happen to me in the midst of the Judean desert, because being all alone in silence, I found myself connecting to the universe and connecting to God, and at the same time connecting to my people and our history. And that humility, that modesty, that understanding of my place in the universe was, on the one hand, a little bit overwhelming, but on the other hand, incredibly liberating. So you have to understand, I signed out of Facebook. I left my work in the capable hands of somebody I had hired to take it over. I said goodbye to my kids. Nobody needed me. My kids are grown. One was living in the house, but grown up and self-sufficient. Nobody needed me at work. I literally was disconnected, but more than disconnected, I had this sense of my own lack of importance, as it were. And even though that can be a little bit disconcerting, it was, in a very positive way, humbling and liberating. And one of the aspects that then developed from that was a sense of not just understanding my place in the universe, but acceptance of who I was and where I was. And again, with an anecdote from the trail itself, I think coming up is a terrific picture of a cliffside where it's not exactly where I was, but it shows a little bit of the situation that I was in on the first day of the trail. I was walking along the cliff. It was about this wide, and I had lost my way, and I didn't know what to do. And I was getting worried as it was getting dark. And I wasn't sure I was going to make it to the night camp where I had buried some water, which was important in terms of being able to continue. And I started to panic. And at one point, I simply said to myself, Artie, you're on the side of a mountain. You have no phone reception. I wanted to try and find a way to call my son and call out Shesha, the special rescue unit of the Air Force, to come and pick me up, take me up the side of this mountain. Forget this idea, no. I had never done a trek like this before. I had hiked and going up in California and the Sierras and the coastal range in California for a day here, a day there, or a backpack overnight, one night, but never something like this. And on the side of that mountain, I basically said to myself, you need to realize that this is where you are. For whatever reason, you've gotten yourself in this position, you need to accept that. This is your reality, accept it, deal with it, and find a way to move on. Doing that there on the side of the trail was the first example of a reinforcement of something that I had to come to terms with. I was one of those people, and some of you know me, I was one of those people who saw myself married for life. To me, marriage was an institution that was permanent. I have absolute respect and nothing negative to say about anybody who gets divorced. I didn't then, I certainly don't now, but it wasn't me. I never expected to find myself in that situation. And yet I had to say to myself, like on the side of the cliff that day, this is your reality. You have to accept it in order to be able to move on. That was the second lesson that I learned. After the humility was the sense of acceptance of the reality that we face in order to be able to then deal with it. So humility was the first, acceptance was the second, and that led directly, accepting that here I am, I'm divorced, deal with it, led directly into a reinforcing of a feeling of this appreciation that I was talking about before. The gratitude that I had for the 28 years of wonderful marriage I had with my wife, Katie, for the faith-based family and home that we built here in Israel, for the privilege of living in Israel at the time of the reestablishment of the sovereignty of the Jewish people in our ancestral homeland, for my parents, for my friends who supported me through all of this traumatic period, and more. The gratitude that I had that was reinforced time and time again, and you can see the number of pictures that I took of flowers, it was a theme in the course of the trip, that applied to my life as well. And that reinforcement became the third lesson of having an appreciation, not just for the physical beauty, but for everything that I had in my life in spite of the trauma that I was facing at the time. The fourth lesson then, having accepted with a sense of humility and with a lot of gratitude for the wonders of my life, opened me up to a very important process that occurred a little bit before the trail, week after week on the trail, and finally ended in the Judean desert with I'm going to use the word epiphany because I can't think of an English word that's more appropriate. It's a little bit bombastic. But with an epiphany that I finally reached from one level to the next, a sense of forgiveness, then carried through week after week of the trail to a point where at the end of the trail, I could forgive. I could forgive my wife. I could forgive myself for mistakes I made, and probably most importantly for me and my psychological and emotional and spiritual health, I could forgive God for putting me in this situation and forcing me to deal with the challenges I was facing. Now, I skipped over the kind of forgiveness that I had to apply while hiking on the trail, but in one sentence, I will say that I had to do a lot of forgiving myself on the trail. Every time I was too hot, I had lost my way, I had carried too much in the... Did I mention I was carrying a 50-pound pack? And the pack was too heavy. I did it and my guitar for the second half of the trip. There was a lot of forgiveness to be done. And because of that, that's what got me into a mode of thinking about forgiveness. And for the record, I don't go into this a lot in the book. My publisher made me take out all the references except two to the Arab Israel conflict. But because we're here in Jerusalem, and because many people sitting here, some of whom I know, are involved in issues of conflict resolution, I will throw out one little hint that my next book, it's already about 75 or 80 pages that are written, because I just took out the references all through the book. Each of the things that I've mentioned, humility, acceptance, which we take in forgiveness, can be applied to our region. And the needs that we have as people, Arabs and Jews, to accept each other, to forgive each other, and more. I'm just throwing that out there because it was most particularly walking through one Arab village in the north, an Arab Muslim village in the north, where I came to this realization on the border with Lebanon, how applicable the lesson I had already internalized for myself of forgiveness, enabling us to move on, how applicable that was and is and will be if we want to reach any sense of peace with our neighbors. So those are the first four lessons, and the last was the most important for me. Having gotten to a point of real forgiveness for everything that had happened to me, the last week of my trail, naturally, I suppose, turned my thoughts to, okay, I've achieved this, amazing, 51 years old, that is something only reserved for the 21-year-old crowd. I hiked 1,000 kilometers through Shul Yisrael, I reconnected to my people. I healed myself to a certain extent through this experience from the trauma that I experienced. And I'm ready to move on with my life, but what am I going to do? Where should I go from here was my question on that last week of the trail. The issue of having a goal, of having a sense of purpose, had obviously accompanied me throughout the trail. Every day I had a goal to finish that day's hike, get to the night camp, and find whatever I buried or purchase new supplies or what have you and get ready for the next day. And I had the general goal of finishing the trail, of course, as a wider goal. And I had the broader goal of moving on with my life and getting over my divorce. That's nothing to build a life on. And that's nothing to give your life meaning. So, as Viktor Frankl talks about in his book, Man's Search for Meaning, I spent that last week thinking about, so where do I go from here? And as I described in the book, I made a few decisions in that last week about my professional career, wanting to join my friend Yossi Abramovitz to work building up this renewable energy platform for Africa, wanting to expand my efforts in helping to articulate some of these issues regarding the Arab-Israel conflict, wanting to be involved in issues between different segments of the Jewish community here in Israel and around the world. And on a personal level, being an even better father than I had been until then with my children and other things. And there's no question that for me, having a goal each day on the trail and having a goal on the trail to finish the hike was immediately applicable to the importance of having a goal for myself and a set of goals to see where my life is next to be. I want to close with the last and most important goal that I set for myself. It wasn't going to be a goal, but I had a realization as I walked along the Yarkon River. Some of you may be familiar with the Namal in Tel Aviv, and the Yarkon River that goes from the sea easterly, and initially, when it out towards Petah Tikva and Ramat HaSharon. What most people don't know is that within about 20 minutes walking, even if you have a 50-pound bag on your back, within 20 minutes you're literally in the wilderness. You're past Gan Yehoshua, and you're out in this winding wilderness path where every now and then, there might be a picture of this here, you see in the distance, wait a second, I'm surrounded by trees, I'm on a beautiful little river path, and yet over there is the mall of Ramat HaSharon. It's so incongruous. As I'm walking from the Namal, I saw in front of me a tree stump that had been stood up and on which had been placed a beautiful array of flowers, purples and pinks and whites and blues. It was stunningly beautiful, but it wasn't the flowers that caught my attention. Two doves had been flitting around as I was walking towards this and settled right in front of these flowers on this tree stump. Now you might imagine at the beginning of the trip, I would have looked at these doves differently. I would have been resentful. How come they can stay? We all know doves stay together for life. How come they can stay together and I couldn't? But at this point in the trail, in the last week of the trail, I was already at a place where I was ready to celebrate. I saw this as something wonderful, this pair of doves that clearly were, in my mind at least, either in love or at least committed to each other, and demonstrating that by landing on these beautiful flowers. At that point, I realized something. I realized that I was ready to love again. I can't say I set myself a goal, because who knows what's going to happen in the future. But in a certain sense, I said, I'm going to be open to fall in love again. And I knew that I had the capacity for that, at least. And a few months later, in fact, a year later, when I was ready to actualize that, having moved from one job into another and having moved ahead with some of the other goals that I had set for myself, I found the love of my life, Miriam, who's here. Although I know what you're going to say, you found me, I know. Miriam found me on J-Date. Talk about gratitude and appreciation, it's important to acknowledge. Hakarat hatov, we call it in Hebrew, recognizing the good that's done for us. And I found Miriam, and you found me, I should say. And to a great extent, that kind of closes the circle in my story of the difficulties and the challenges that I faced, the height that I took that taught me so much, not just only new things, but reasserting or reigniting in me an understanding of the importance of humility, of appreciation, of forgiveness, of acceptance, and of having a sense of purpose in life to help us direct ourselves and to move forward with our lives. That's the story of my Israel trail. And I called the book My Israel Trail very purposefully. On the one hand, this is my story. I had a personal story of the personal growth that I experienced over the course of the hike and afterwards. But also because, and I haven't dwelled on this in detail, if you read the book, if you choose to go down that path, and you'll see that a lot of, almost daily, a lot of my observations and the emotional impact of hiking the trail for me was 1,000 or 1,000,000 times more significant than for anybody hiking the Appalachian Trail, or the Pacific Crest Trail, or in the Himalayas, or the treks in Nepal, or the Pilgrim's Trail from France to Spain, because this is my Israel trail. And I don't mean that in a possessive sense, my country. I mean that this is the land of our ancestors. And I felt time after time that I was walking in the footsteps, if not the footsteps of the children of Israel, as they escaped persecution in Egypt and wandered through the desert for 40 years. I wandered for 42 days. If not in the actual footsteps of the children of Israel, certainly in the footsteps of our prophets. I'll share with you one last anecdote, and with that I'll close. In the north, right near the forest of Baran, but before it, right near the border of Lebanon, I'm hiking through a forest next to a little stream, actually right near here, just over that hill over there. This is the view from the Trail Angel room at the kibbutz of Baran. I'm hiking along a path, and I see ahead of me a small tomb, painted blue, kind of domed like this, a little fence around it, and there's a little sign on it. The sign says, Kever Shel של ישעיהו בן עמוס. I kind of don't pay attention. I stop for a second for a rest. I think, wait a second, I look it up because I had reception. I turned my phone on, it was off for most of my trip. This is, I didn't translate it on purpose for those of you who don't speak Hebrew. Yeshayahu ben Amoz is Isaiah. Yes, that Isaiah. Plows and what is it?
Swords
and plowshares, Isaiah. In the middle of nowhere with no road to it. Not a pilgrimage site like others that one can think of where hundreds of thousands of people go. This is the prophet Isaiah's tomb in the middle of a forest. Now for the record, I also looked afterwards as I was writing the book, and there's some argument about the historicity. Is the prophet Isaiah buried here near Jerusalem? Cliff, who's a tour guide, could tell us. There are arguments as to, is that really the tomb of prophet Isaiah, or is he buried in Jerusalem, or perhaps elsewhere? But that's not what's important. It didn't matter to me whether it was absolutely true or if it was just a tradition. What was important, like the tomb of Hannah, which I found as I stumbled down from Svat to rejoin the trail after a Shabbat there. Or like my walking through the Judean desert and recognizing whether King David actually fled right to there or more a bit north in the hills around Jerusalem, it was the conceptual framework. When I call it my Israel trail, the connection that I had to our people, to our history, to our homeland, and to a great extent to our shared destiny is part of the story and part of the reason I wrote the book. So if you're interested in reading the book, or if you know others who haven't had a chance to hike the trail but might like to vicariously walk the trail with me, or others who are perhaps facing their own personal challenges, as I know many of you have, who might perhaps benefit from my perspective, which brings nothing new to bear, but a different combination of things, a different way of looking things, then I'm certainly very grateful for you for coming this evening and for listening and for reading or sharing the story with others. Thank you very much. I'm happy to take questions or discussion. Yeah.
I was going to ask you, so I know that there's something called trail angels, who like host people hiking the trail. Did you avail yourself of that, or you want to kind of like just be on your own?
I'm so glad you asked the question, because I often speak about trail angels, and I want to, and not least because there's at least one sitting here in the room. But I didn't go into it in detail, which is why I love both when we have the interactive question and answer period, but also specifically to start with that. There is something unique about the Israel Trail. Many of you may know something about the Appalachian Trail, for instance, where there are little lean-tos, three-sided little huts with a broom and a mattress, and that's it. And volunteers maintain that, and believe me, I'm sure people, like if you read Bill Bryson's book, A Walk in the Woods, people appreciate that. But trail angels are an institution almost unique to Israel. These are people who open their homes to shvilistim, hikers on the shvil, without any request for compensation. And whether it's a bed and a shower, a hot meal often, they'll do your laundry, they'll take you back to the trailhead if it's not too close. It's an institution which is very much part of the family feel, which also leads to why I chose the title for the book, that this is our Israel Trail. And I want to make it clear, yes, most of the population of Israel, 80% or so, are members of the Jewish people, and most of the trail angels are also Jews, but many of them aren't. Bedouin, Druze, Christian Arabs, and others. I spent two-thirds of the trail I stepped out in the field, in answer specifically to your question, and one-third, about a third of the time, about 15 nights or so, I did spend with trail angels, either because I wanted or needed a break or a shower, or because it was rainy or the weather was inclement, what have you. So I could give a whole lecture on the amazing Shabbatot, Shabbats that I spent, the seven Shabbats that I spent on the trail. One of them was with the amazingly warm and welcoming community of what are informally known as the Black Hebrews, or the African Israelites of Jerusalem, who have their community called the Peace Village, the Village of Peace in Dimona. And Prince Emmanuel Ben Yehuda has been a friend for many, many years, more years than probably either of us want to count, had said to me, had said to me when I said I was going to hike the trail, and my team in Media Central gave me a little send-off. They gave me, by the way, this t-shirt, not too old to walk the trail. I wore that t-shirt, which I don't think was their intention, every single day of the trail.
I'm not going to put that in
I did wash it occasionally, and in fact, I remember very well, exhausted arriving at the Peace Village, and one of your sons coming and saying, give me your laundry, we'll do your laundry, which I hadn't intended, and I don't really think I asked for, it was so sweet. Came with a bag. And so, yes, I did wash it at least occasionally, I mean, a couple of days. But the Shabbat that I spent at the Peace Village was one of the most unique and wonderful experiences of the trail. Because the village, I happen to be vegetarian, the village is entirely vegan. Their hospitality was incredible. Vince Manuel asked me to speak on Friday night, and that was an incredible experience, and not least because, and you see how these things connect. That week I had been thinking about appreciation, about gratitude. It was the second week of the trail. First week, as I said, was focused on humility, and the second week just worked out that way. I had just been contemplating, walking through the desert, the issues of appreciation and gratitude that I was referring to. And Vince Manuel said that this was their Shabbat of appreciation, their annual Shabbat of appreciation. I don't remember which parsha it is. I know I say so in the book. And you asked me to speak on Friday night. And that was an incredible experience, not least because of the fun of speaking with your community, was, I guess part of the fun was the exuberance of the community. I'd give occasional divrei Torah, or little small words of Torah at our synagogue, which last about 10 or 15 minutes every few months. So it's something that I speak in synagogues around the world. But I've never spoken to as enthusiastic a community that were not just welcoming, but shouting out, hallelujah, amen, brother, and singing. It was a lot of fun. But more than that, Emmanuel and I, who have been friends for a long time, really also bonded on that Shabbat in a very special way. And so the answer about trail angels I won't give you, because I don't want to force you to be bored through all. You're welcome to read the book. I describe every Shabbat. But I had a Shabbat at the desert ashram in the south at Shittim, which was set up by a bunch of Israelis who went off to India. And they said, why do we have to go all the way to India to have an ashram Indian meditative experience with everything that goes with it? You can read about it in the book. That was fascinating. Then a lovely Shabbat spiritual high in Tzfat, in the holy city of Safed. Another one in Kibbutz Kanaton, which is an egalitarian, non-denominational community trying to revitalize ideas of what Shabbat observance and religious observance itself means. My last Shabbat I spent on the Sharon beach. You saw the picture of my tent on the beach. And that was an experience in and of itself, because how often do those of us who are religiously observant see how the non-observant side, half, part, majority of the country celebrate their Shabbat? And when I say celebrate their Shabbat, I'm choosing my words specifically, because it wasn't just amazing to see. I've been to the beach on a Friday or during Chol HaMoed. I know what a busy beach can look like. There was nothing like this Shabbat on the Chof HaSharon, on the Sharon beach. It was like, I don't know, one of those beaches in Los Angeles or Buenos Aires where you can't move because there's so many people. Music and frisbees and people riding and jet skis and all the rest of it. But you know what else there was? Friday night, there was a group of clearly secular university students, about 30 of them, sitting around a campfire, not keeping the Sabbath as traditionally, singing Sabbath songs, singing Shabbat songs. And there was a family down the beach to me. I noticed as I took a walk in the morning where the father was making Kiddush for the family there by their beach towels. They came to spend the day at the beach. They didn't walk there, they clearly drove. And yet, whole interesting appreciation. So trail angels and my Shabbat experiences are things you can read more about in the book. Yeah.
What did you do about food and water?
Well, as I said, I buried about five or six times. In three different locations, I buried my own water in the desert. This only applies to the 3 weeks of the desert. In the north, in the center of the country, you basically have access to little stores of makolas, either at gas stations or in different small communities, either on the trail or within a kilometer or two, which is actually a little bit difficult, because once you've hiked 28 kilometers in one day, you really don't want to do another 2 kilometers off the trail, but buy yourself some water and then 2 kilometers back. So that's, but in the desert, you really have to. There are places that you cannot access. So I buried a few supplies in a few places, and in other places I paid a desert tour company to deliver water to me. Twice it wasn't there. And one of the reasons that you pay through the nose, you pay an exorbitant amount for 6 liters of water. I mean, it's 6 liters. You can buy 6 liters of water for 10 shekels in a Makoda, right, or 15, right? You pay 120 shekels for those 6 liters of water. But one of the reasons you pay that is because they guarantee it's going to be there. So one time I had to hike up 45 minutes to get reception from my phone and call the guy at 11 at night to say to him, there's no water here, because it was stolen. And it was clearly stolen because there were water bottles all over the place, empty water bottles, which normally doesn't happen. And he came out while I was asleep at 1:30 in the morning in his Jeep. It took him 45 minutes to get there from his, where he lives near in Staple Care. Another time I just happened to run into a bunch of guys at the night camp that were there only for one night. They had extra water, so that was okay. But it's kind of like a James Bond thing because he gives you directions. You see the shrub at the end of the, this way you take a left and go 10 meters and up on the embankment under a rock, you'll find the water. And that particular time I found a reception, I called him, I said he's not there, he said go this way, he said go that way, just literally like that, by the idea. So, I mean, that's basically the answer. You resupply either by worrying or by deliveries or by just hiking off the trail in order to find it.
And food?
Food I carried with me supplies enough for about 2 days or sometimes three at a time. As a vegetarian, means I couldn't carry, didn't choose to carry tins of tuna or other things you could basically survive on. So I ate a lot of quinoa, and I ate a lot of oatmeal. I got very sick of quinoa, oatmeal, and energy bars, and oatmeal bars, believe me. And some fruits and vegetables that you could carry that wear well, like a carrot, a few carrots and apples. That's basically what I survived on. But I got a hint, actually, out of Cheryl Strayed's book Wild, which I read about 3 weeks before I went on the hike. My brother had sent it to me. I had never heard of it. It wasn't made into a movie yet. She had put together halfway through her trail a little packet of stuff like spices and salt and pepper and different herbs and things. And I got that. And so I found in a hardware store a little thing where normally it's used a plastic holder of different size nails type of thing. And I threw all the nails away. I asked him, could I buy it without the nails? He said, there's no, if 10 shekels with the nails, then fine. I took it, threw all the nails, I mean, put them in a place that I would never find them again. And so that at least enabled me to have a little bit of a mifan, of a variety of flavors for every night that I made the quinoa. Yeah.
Would you say, actually, let me rephrase it. What do you think was the toughest place or the toughest moments you encountered while hiking the trail?
So there's a picture here of the Carbonate, which when it comes back up, I'll point to it. That's known as the hardest day on the trail. The Red Guide, which is kind of the informal guide to the trail, written by a fellow named Jakob Saar, about whom I had to exercise a lot of forgiveness in the course of this trail, because of the times he says, yeah, do this in one day, and it's impossible to do that in one day. Or, you have to see this breathtaking view, it's worth taking an extra hour off the trail to hike up to the top of Mount Shlomo, for instance, Mount Solomon, overlooking Eilat, right? Halfway up, I feel like Frodo climbing up Mount Doom, hand over foot, exhausted, end of the day. What is this guy talking about? So I had a lot of forgiveness to exercise with regard to Yanko, but the Red Guide describes the Carbonate as the hardest day in the trek, and that it definitely was. And one of the reasons it's hard, which is why I'm waiting for the picture, is that you're hiking along the rim of the large crater, which somebody mentioned earlier. And on the rim of the large crater, you're hiking both on an uneven path where one foot is higher than the other. There are winds that are blowing you. Literally could blow you off the side of the crater. Miriam's promised to do the hike with me again once her youngest son is safely tucked away in the army or otherwise, but she refused.
Except for the
government. Except for the government. Except for the dangerous places. So that was definitely one of them. And there were places which I really did fear for my life, at least in the sense of not being sure of myself enough and having to take it much slower or sit down or recalibrate or what have you. There was one point when I literally, and I think I have a picture of this too, where I literally was striding ahead because I was confident and in good mood and singing to myself, And that part of the trail right south of Staples-Care. And I got to a place called Ein Hod, and Hod Akev. And Ein Hod was before, but Hod Akev is a little mountain which will come up shortly. And I'm striding along with no cares in the world and not really looking too far ahead of me. And I literally almost walked off a cliff.
Wow.
Because the trail comes to the edge of the cliff and you have to go down. And there's no sign. There's no like sign saying, you know, here down, right? You get the trail literally goes up and disappears. And only when you get to it and look over it and look down, you say, oh, there's a handhold here. Oh, and there's a trail sign down there. The trail sign, of course, I think you've recognized. There's those three stripes that I took a lot of pictures of. And that was both frightening in of itself, but dangerous, not only because I almost fell, but actually I stood there and looked down. I thought, I can't do this with a 50-pound bag. It was one of the more mature decisions I took. There are advantages to doing this as an adult, because you actually can take these decisions responsibly. I called actually the daughter of a friend, tried to get her on the phone to ask, did she go down this? Turns out she didn't answer at that point. It turns out she had hiked up it. She had come in the other direction, which is a little easier. But there were two guys down below, that's why I'm waiting for the photo to come up very quickly. There were two guys about 200 meters down below, or 300 meters down below, and I called down to them in Hebrew, and I said, is this possible? Is this doable to go down here? And one of them goes, Ken, I'm gonna say, Mr. Khan, this is it. This is the cliff that I almost fell off, and this is the way you come down. This is the cliff looking down, and here are the two guys right there that I'm yelling to. And I'm looking at this thing, and I'm like, I can't do that. So I yelled down to them, is this possible? They said, yeah, I'm taking. This is the car bullet, by the way, thank you. Where you walk along here, on that path there, right? And the wind's blowing you over there, and you're off balance. Anyway, I called down to these two guys. Can you do this? He said, yeah, but take it slow. And I said, and with the 50-pound pack on your back? And they said, no, alta seites, it's sakhanat chayim. Don't do it. You're in danger of death. So I took a mature decision, turned around, walked 3 hours back, almost to in the camp, back under, beneath where I said the water is, around the mountain of Hod Akev, until I got to where I took that picture from, instead of going down that windy path, where I found the night camp. So there were some dangerous elements. The only other one I'll share with you, just because it's a little bit an interesting one, is I lost my way one day through the forest of Meitar, right below the forest of Yatir. And I miscalculated the day. This happened all the time. I learned navigation in Boy Scouts and in the IDF, and it served me well for part of the time, but other parts of the times, I forgot to read, for instance, elevation. It's probably a good idea to know, if you're going to go for 28 kilometers, how are you going to go up and down 1,000 meters, or is it going to be more or less flat? I kept ignoring that, even when I paid for it and supposedly learned a lesson. So on this day, it was downhill through Yar Yatir, through the Yatir Forest, it's the Meitar Forest, so I got to Meitar, and I had miscalculated it. So I'm hiking in the dark, in the Meitar Forest, and I lost the trail. I didn't know where I was going. And all of a sudden, in front of me, I have a headlamp on low. I see two red lights in front of me, eyes. And then I saw another pair, and another pair. I counted 30 pairs of eyes surrounding me in the middle of the forest, where I had no idea where I was going. They were jackals. Now, where I live in Beit Shemesh, we get jackals behind the house howling in the evening. I'm used to jackals. Are carnivores, but then you notice they don't eat, you know, people. But then again, you never know. And if they're hungry, there are 30 of them. So again, I started to panic, but I and I just turned my headlight on high, and I started walking very fast with my walking sticks making a big noise, and I started to sing at the top of my lungs, zippity doo da. And I just flattened through them. They kind of parted, and I just got through them, and fortunately they didn't follow me, because I really wasn't sure what I was going to do if they followed me, because I didn't know where I was going. In the end, I found the path, and I made it, and a trail angel saved me, insisted. This is the last thing I'll say about trail angels. If there's another question, I'm happy to continue, and otherwise I don't want you to feel like you're a captive audience, and you have to stay, so I'll take one more question, and I'm happy to stick around. Of course, if you'd like to purchase the book, I'm happy. I'm offering them, as I mentioned earlier, to some of you at a discount. They cost 79 shekels in the bookstore, and I'm happy to sell them for 50 shekels. shekels, and of course happy to sign them and dedicate them to you or to anybody you'd like to. But I'm happy to stick around also for further conversation if you'd like, just don't want to keep everybody here. But the last thing I want to say about trail angels is that at Maitar, at 8:30 at night, I finally found a night camp outside the village, the little moshav of Maitar, and I called the trail angel who I had arranged to go to, because I'm polite, because I'm not 21, I'm 51, and I understand that this is a nice thing to do. And I said, listen, very much appreciate your hospitality, but I'm not going to come. I'm here, I'm late, I'm just going to set up camp, I'm already building a tent, thank you very much. I spoke to the teenage daughter of the host. She said, okay, but stay here, close the phone. 30 seconds later, I get a phone call from the mother, who's my age. She's Bashum Pani Balofer, Ani Lo Mashiach Lavad Bashetah. There's no way I'm leaving you alone out there in the fields. We're coming to get you. Now, the funny part of the story is, that's the nice part. There's another nice part, but the middle part is, they lost their way. Instead of 10 minutes to get to me from literally inside the village, they couldn't find me, they got lost, they called the kabat, the security officer of their village, to try and figure out. They lit up the lights on the outside of the village as if it was a security event to find out where this bloody hiker is, so they can find him, bring him home. But it was wonderful. That is the kind of person that you're talking about, that doesn't just open their homes, but she refused to let a guy who wanted to just go to sleep in his tent stay. And they fed me a shower, and they took me to the trailer the next morning, and that's kind of, that's why they're called angels. One last question.
Question is, how much of that book was developed during your reflection when you were traveling, facing